We've been there and we survived. It's truly fantastic, and you can visit it every day of the year if you're in Los Angeles. You can meet parasaurolophuses, stegosaurs, and also rexes and raptors. It's so good, it's almost real. Almost. In this program, we'll find out why there are no dinos left, and if we'll ever be able to create the real thing.
Extinction's a miserable process. In the next 5 years, we could lose black rhinos, Siberian tigers, and lowland gorillas, and it would all be our fault. Since the turn of the century, we've lost thousands of species like that, and we never seem to wise up. And you know, one thing's for certain, and I hate to say it, one day we're going to be extinct ourselves. But we have to remember that extinction is a natural process. Things have to disappear just so that new species can evolve to take their place. The problem is that we've sped that process up too much. We're killing things too quickly for any other animals to replace them. But we didn't make the dinosaurs extinct. You can't blame us for that one. We weren't even around. But extinct they are, and the reasons for that have paleontologists at each other's throats like a couple of rabid tyrannosaurs. Here lies Timmy the Triceratops, last of the ceratopsian dinosaurs, died of unknown causes 65 million years ago. I wonder what really did him in.
One of the most exciting theories to explain the disappearance of the dinosaurs was formulated in 1980 by Walter Alvarez at Berkeley, California. And you've heard all about it. It says that a giant meteorite smashed into the Earth with disastrous results. Now, I'm no astronomer, but I know a man who is.
Try this. You'll see things you simply won't believe.
Ah. Hey! This makes faraway things look close up. Wow! Cool!
Well, why not borrow it after dark? I can spend hours looking at the moon on planets through a telescope. What's the Parasaurolophus's name?
Lophus, he's my friend.
Well, he's keen to learn, that's for sure.
He's got a heart of gold.
Well, one thing I have learnt is that these kids really like me. Now, if I could just convince Christophilus Packham,
Well, did you want me to tell you about the meteorite theory?
Yes. What was Chicxulub?
It's the place on the American coast where we found a big crater that may mark the place where a huge chunk of material, a meteorite, hit the Earth, something like 65 million years ago, just about the time when the dinosaurs died out.
What is the double impact theory?
The theory is that the meteorite came from space, burst through the outer part of the Earth's crust, then went inside the Earth and caused a tremendous outburst. The material was thrown up and actually put into a path around the Earth. And we've also found traces of stuff called iridium, and you associate that with meteorites.
What were the effects of the impact?
Tremendous volcanic eruptions, huge tidal waves, and of course a huge cloud of dust that spread all over the Earth and cut out the sun's light and altered the climate so much that the dinosaurs simply couldn't cope.
Could there be another big meteor impact?
There could. There are things whizzing around the solar system, and we could be hit by one of them. But please don't get worried. The chances of the Earth being hit by a large meteorite in the near future are very, very slight.
Phew, well, that's a relief.
On the other hand, there is at least a chance that the dinosaurs were wiped out by the impact of a meteorite that hit the Earth something like 65 million years ago.
Well, that's certainly a pretty impressive theory, and Patrick makes it sound really convincing. And if 80 to 90% of all life on Earth disappeared one night at the end of the Cretaceous, something dramatic must have happened. But you know, I think there's more to it than just the meteorite. I think there are other factors involved. And at the moment, a paleontologist is unearthing a fossil on the Isle of Wight, which might give me some evidence to support this theory.
Hi there, Nick.
Hello there, Chris.
How's it going?
Not so bad.
Oh, I can see some bones here. Look at that.
Yeah.
What's that
here. This looks like a bit of rib.
Yeah, that's correct. That's a rib there. That looks very much like a vertebra.
Yeah.
So the spindle-shaped bone.
Hey, look, tooth as well. There,
yeah, one tooth with a crown on it there and the roots down there.
That's fantastic, the crown, where it's still shiny, isn't it?
Beautiful preservation. You can see all these very fine lines down the surface there. It's perfect.
How did you find this fossil?
There were basic pieces of bone, broken pieces of bone, sticking out of this clay bed here. The small fragments exposed, and I've dug away a bit to expose a bit more.
And what's this here? This looks
fantastic.
Well,
underneath here looks very interesting, and I'll just dig away a bit and try and clear it, and we'll see. Lift that off, and...
Just look at that! That's fantastic, isn't it? It looks like an armour plate or something.
Yeah, that's right. That's a scute. It's a thick, bony plate. From the back of an animal, as you say, armour plating, basically.
It's pretty big as well. How big would this animal have been, do you think?
Well, I would estimate somewhere between about 12 and 16 feet long.
And what would the world that it lived in have been like compared to today?
It'd be very, very warm. You're talking about 120 million years ago in the Lower Cretaceous. So a very warm climate. This area at the time was very swampy, flat-lying land, fairly lush vegetation, very, very different from it is today.
What about the skull, though? I mean, that's always the prize of any find,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, we found a fragment here.
Well, look at
that. It's a piece of the skull.
That's lovely, isn't it?
And you can
see...
Are
these the tooth holes,
yeah,
as it were?
You can see some broken-off roots of teeth in there, in the socket there.
Oh, that's brilliant, isn't it?
If I turn it over... The
it looks like
surface.
A nose or something.
Yeah, well, it is. It's the end of the snout, and that there is the nostril.
That's brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. But with all of those tooth holes on the other side, and that particularly sharp tooth there, what type of food do you think this animal would have eaten?
Well, these teeth here, that's typical of a meat-eating animal. That's a carnivore. There's no doubt of that at all.
Million-dollar question, then. What type of animal was this?
Well, it's a crocodile.
A crocodile. You see, crocodilians are still very much with us. This stunning spectacled caiman certainly is, and they've been around for the last 200 million years. Clearly, they didn't become extinct when the meteorite hit. But then nor did sharks, turtles, tortoises or toads, and all of these animals were breathing when Triceratops here was. What scientists don't know is why these guys made it and these guys didn't. T-Rex, the Hadrosaurs, and the Ceratopsians, like Triceratops here, all became extinct very, very quickly in the space of 250,000 years. Now, I know that sounds a long time, but in dinosaur time, that is very quickly. And none of their remains have been found above the iridium layer. None of them survived the meteorite. But these guys did, and that means that the meteorite can't provide the whole of the answer. Perhaps there was some other earth-shattering event at the end of the Cretaceous period that might share the blame.
Throughout the Earth's history, all of the continents have been on the move. They began as one large lump, and then about 100 million years ago, they all drifted apart. It's called plate tectonics, and it's a process which changed everything.
This was the result. Overall, the Earth became very much colder. As the continents collided, they pushed up mountains, and this increased rainfall. In some places, deserts were formed where there was once rainforest. Ocean currents changed. And in both the northern and the southern hemispheres, the land masses drifted away from the equator. Now, dinosaurs got stuck on these new islands, stuck, just like me, in the freezing cold. But if overall it got cooler, in some places it got very much hotter.
All of this shifting of the Earth's plates led to a massive increase in the number of volcanoes. They threw up tons and tons of ash, loads of poisonous gases, and even a layer of iridium, the meteorite element.
But why should cooling have done in the dinos and not the crocs? After all, in last week's programme, we said at least some species of dinosaur were hot-blooded. Well, whether hot-blooded or not, they are still reptiles, and some reptiles have a problem with cold eggs. Let me explain. In alligators and crocodiles, for instance, whether the animal develops into a male or a female depends on the temperature of the egg during the process of incubation. If it never gets above 32 degrees centigrade, the animal becomes a female. If it gets above 33.5 degrees centigrade, then it becomes a male. Quite simply, if the Earth had cooled enough, it wouldn't have been long before all we had were female dinosaurs. Pretty boring, but also a strategy doomed to extinction.
OK, Tom. Ready?
Yeah, I know exactly what to do. I think. Troy, can you help me?
Yeah, sure. Initiate time period. Cretaceous. There.
You'd think Chris would be here, being as we're talking about birds and eggs.
Somebody say bird. Sorry, Fi, I didn't mean to scare you. But you haven't started collecting that egg information yet, then.
You'll be back in virtual reality any moment now.
Wow. No matter how many times I use this VR equipment, it still feels like the ultimate computer game.
Well, just remember, treat this as a scientific experiment, and whatever you do, don't disturb the adults or the eggs in the nest.
You've got to find a nest first. Wait, I think there might be something over there. Faye, what kind of info are we to collect?
General measurements, temperature. Oh, and the patterns on the eggs. Hey, look, over there. There's something in the hollowed out patch in the ground.
Oh, yeah. Don't know what variety of dinosaur laid those eggs in. Take a closer look.
Yeah, find out what position they were actually laid in. Some dinosaurs laid them in circles or even spirals, and one, Protoceratops, often laid up to 20 eggs in a communal nest, all arranged in a circle like a donut.
We haven't discovered any viviparous dinosaurs, have we, Chris?
Eh? What are they when they're at home?
Dinosaurs that gave birth to live young. And no, we haven't discovered them yet, but I bet we will. Because vivipary is a great adaptation for cold-blooded animals that live in cold places. Adders, for instance, they can live further north than the Arctic Circle because they give birth to live young. If they laid eggs, the eggs would simply freeze.
Uh-oh.
Problem? Mum on the way back?
Dad too. And they don't look too happy that we're looking in their nest.
Hey, what will we do?
I think we'll get out of here.
Shutting down computer simulation program.
Phew, that was a bit hairy.
Eh? Hairy?
Figure of speech.
We'll just input the data we gathered about the eggs into the computer. And shift up for us.
I tell you what, one thing we noticed is that the eggs in the center of the nest were a lot warmer than the ones at the edge.
Yeah, that ties in with what I said earlier about temperature, egg, sex determination. Of all of the fossils we've seen in this series, this has to be the most fantastic. For me, even better than the Archaeopteryx we examined in the Natural History Museum. It's a 70 million year old segnosaur egg. It came from China and it's been exquisitely prepared by paleotechnician Terry Manning. And just look at the detail. This is the tiny skull of what was once the embryo. You can even see the teeth in its jawbone. And here are some tiny vertebrae. And just look at this, the claw of this animal which never hatched. And that's the tragedy. I'm afraid this egg died 70 million years ago. It's not going to break open and allow us to see a living dinosaur. That's impossible. Or is it? You saw the film, you may have read the book, you probably wore the t-shirt, ripped it, and now your dad's cleaning the car with it. But is this the key to Jurassic Park? This is an insect trapped in amber. And as you know, in the film, scientists managed to remove some dinosaur DNA from this blood-sucking insect and produce new living animals. Well, real scientists have done that, but as yet they've only managed to recover a tiny, tiny fragment of ancient DNA. We need so much more. After all, you can't build a house if you've only got a couple of bricks. And the other problem is sterility. This place has to be ultra clean because the whole process is easily contaminated with human DNA. But it is a useful thing. It allows us to explore the field of taxonomy, to know which dinosaurs were most closely related to which other dinosaurs. And I've got an inkling that in about 25 years' time or so, all of this science will improve enough to allow us to pull this stunt off. But I can't wait 25 years. I want to go to Jurassic Park right now.
Halfway through the ride, something goes terribly wrong. we get knocked off course. And the next thing we know, we're coming face to face with raptors and spitters and probably even a T-Rex or two.
How long has it taken to put the ride together?
We've actually been working on this ride for over 5 years. That's before the movie went into production. Steven Spielberg and our designers were working on this at the same time he was designing the movie.
The movie is about basically a theme park that goes amiss. And we thought it was, at one point somebody said, what are the theme parks more successful than the movie? And I said, that could happen. Who knew? But it's great. It's just beyond my wildest dreams.
Pretty accurate.
Yeah. Was it fun, though? That's the issue.
Yeah.
Had a good time.
Oh, I did love it.
Oh, wow. That's awesome. Henry says it's very scary. Incredible.
Who built the dinosaurs, and how much research did they put into recreating these animals as close as they possibly could to what we think the real animals are or were like?
First of all, we worked with paleontologists to make sure that we had all the details right and really understood not only what dinosaurs look like, but how they behave so that their pattern of movement would be realistic. Simultaneously, we had engineers first create virtual dinosaurs in a computer database so that we could actually turn them and make them move exactly how we wanted them to. And that then became the blueprint for the mechanical systems for the dinosaurs, which are quite sophisticated. And at the same time, another team of chemists was working on silicone compounds and things to come up with a skin that would not only be durable enough to withstand the elements out here on the ride, but also have the stretch and look lifelike.
How do they work?
Well, it's a hydraulic-based system, but it's actually very sophisticated in that normal hydraulics, you know, you think of a robot moving in a very jerky fashion. These dinosaurs employ a system called compliance, which means that all of the movements of the dinosaur are linked together, kind of like the human nervous system talks to all the muscles in our body, so that one, when one arm moves, it isn't just simply that motion happening, but that move transfers all the way through the shoulder and through the weight of the body, so that it creates a very fluid and realistic movement.
Which of the species here has the most complex series of movements?
I think our raptor has probably the most. The biggest figure on the ride actually moves at 25 feet per second. He has the same thrust as a commercial jet engine. He's really spectacular in it. Keeping the dinosaurs working was one of our biggest challenges. They have to withstand living in the water in some cases. They have to work all of the time. And that's why they're so sophisticated. The engineering on them is really quite astounding. Not only will all the dinosaurs be doing things you would expect a dinosaur to be doing, eating, coming down to the shore to graze, bathing in the geysers, but the thing that's most significant is that they're aware of the presence of us in the ride. They watch us go by, they react to us, and in the later parts of the ride even come after us. The cost of the ride was about $110 million. It lasts about 5.5 minutes, and we can handle about 3,000 people an hour. We want to make sure everybody gets a chance to have this experience.
I changed my mind!
So here we are in Hollywood, where everyone's dreams come true. But if we did recreate real dinosaurs, there'd be a few nightmares. The atmosphere, for instance. When the dinos were alive, it was a lot richer in oxygen. Could they really breathe this? And what about the climate? Could they cope with all this sunshine? In fact, we'd have to build a whole new ecosystem. All of the millions of species of plants and fungi, and then all of the insects to pollinate and eat them, and then all of the animals to in turn eat those insects, so at last the dinosaurs would have something to eat themselves. And given that we can't even look after the ecosystems that we've already got, the chances of building a new one seem pretty unlikely. And what would all the herbivores eat? Of all the plant species that grew millions of years ago, only a few are still with us. I mean, I can't see Diplodocus tucking into an oak tree or Triceratops enjoying a daffodil salad, can you? But imagine we did it, the whole business, dinosaurs, everything. There'd be one last problem. None of the animals would have any immunity to modern diseases. Just imagine Dilophosaurus with rabies. No thanks.
I'll get the milk.
Okay.
So there we go. We might get to see dinosaurs in our lifetime, if we're really lucky. But you know what I think? I think we ought to spend more time looking after the animals we've got. Two rhinos in the bush is worth loads of DNA in the test tube, if you ask me. And think about it. We've been living with a dinosaur now for a few weeks, and it hasn't been a bed of roses, has it?
A bed of roses? Yum, yum.
And where is Loafers, anyway?
Hello. We've had a call about the escaped para...
Can't even say parasaur loafers.
Have you seen anything, sir?
Well, actually,
News just in of a young dinosaur at light somewhere in the south of England. The animal, a Parasaurolophus, was created in a secret laboratory by isolating fossilized DNA to grow an embryo, the technique featured in the film Jurassic Park. The real thing last roamed wild in the United States 70 million years ago and is understood to be plant-eating and harmless. The dinosaur has not been seen for 3 days after escaping from an unlocked cage. And if you see the 2.5-year-old dinosaur, you reject its friendly advances and ring the emergency services.
No, I haven't seen anything like a dinosaur around here. Have you, Troy?
Troy?
Nope, not me. What about you, Lauren?
No. How about you, Tom?
No, sorry, mate. Nothing around here. What have I done?
Yes!
Yay! Brilliant!
Checkmate! Cool!
If you have any questions about dinosaurs, ring the Dinosaur Society on 01227 700 116. But please get permission before you use the phone. That's 01227 700 116. Well, that's just...